So, yes, hello. I'm very happy to be here finally. So I'm Daphné Ravelosona. I'm the CTO and co-founder of Spinion Technology, and I'm also a researcher at C2N in Paris-Saclay. So today I'm gonna introduce a new manufacturing process based on helium ion irradiation to enhance the performance of spintronic devices. And this is basically the PhD work of Rian van der Haar, who is going to defend his PhD next Monday. So first, let me introduce very briefly Spinion Technology. So we are quite old now. We have been created in 2017. So we are a spin-off of Paris-Saclay CNRS based on 20 years of research on ion irradiation. We have now a large portfolio of patent and strong know-how. We have 12 employees, including 10 in R&D. And we have a strong partnership with leading academic and industrial partners. And what we are doing is developing innovative ion beam solution. So for MRAM, magnetic sensors, and neuromorphic application. So all based on a magnetic material and basically magnetic tunnel junction. So what we propose to our customers today is we propose ion beam foundry services. So basically they send their material or chips. We treat them with different processes we have developed. And we also provide customers irradiated materials and devices. We also provide some R&D ion beam tools for academic research, up to 200 millimeter wafer today. And at the end, we also propose manufacturing solutions through IP licensing. Okay, so today I'm gonna talk about reducing structural inhomogeneities in spintronic material. As it has been said by Lucien before, this could be a strong limitation for all these applications if you have a variability. And as you know, in these ultra-thin magnetic films, you have layers down to a few atomic planes. And because of that, the manufacturing process is very challenging and introduce defect, structural inhomogeneities, which limit the yield, the density, and the reliability of this spintronic application like MRAM, but also magnetic sensors. And those defects are either intrinsic. So in this magnetic tunnel junction, for example, you have interface roughness, interface intermixing. You have a different crystalline texture for in each grain. And it can be also extrinsic, like edge damages induced by the manufacturing process, basically etching. And so in this talk, I'm going to show you that it's possible to reduce this intrinsic and extrinsic defect by using a post-growth process based on helium irradiation. So first, I'm going to introduce the process so based on this light ions, and then I will show you two different examples improving crystallization in this cobalt iron boron MgO materials and also reducing edge damages in cobalt iron boron MgO devices. Okay, so why are we using helium ions? Because they are light, and when they go through the material, they transfer a very low amount of energy. And basically, if you look at gallium or argon, for example, they induce a higher transfer of energy, and you can induce damages in the material because you have a cascade collision. With helium ions, you only induce a short-range atomic displacement. So basically, you transfer energy to one target atom, and this target atom doesn't have enough energy to move other atom in the material. So no structural damages, and with this post-growth technique or post-process technique, you can have a very precise control of atomic order. So basically, you can move atom by atom in your material. And the condition we are using is all the helium ions are implanted deep into the substrate, so below the magnetic layer. So the usefulness of light ion versus heavy ion is shown here. If you compare, for example, here six helium ions in silicon on six gallium ions in silicon for the same energy, you can see the displacement in the material along the trajectory of the ions. And you can see that for gallium, you have many cascade collisions, and basically you destroy the crystal. This is why you can etch with gallium, or you can etch with argon, but you cannot etch the material with helium. You only induce some atomic rearrangement. So this is shown here. So what happens when an incident ion hits a target atom? So here, T is a transfer energy from the incoming ions. In metals, if the transfer energy is below 25 electron volts, nothing happens. You are below the displacement threshold. If the energy is too high, like gallium, for example, so you move this green atom very far away, and then you destroy the crystal, and you have a stable vacancy on interstitial here. But if you are in between, you can get a local recombination. And basically, either you get back to the initial state, which is not interesting at all, or you get a pairwise exchange. And the probability of these two situations is not 50-50 because thermodynamics play a role. Basically, if you look at the diffusion coefficient under irradiation, you are a first term which is ballistic. So this is basically what I showed you before. It's like playing a pool. And a second term, which is related to thermodynamic and basically proportional to the enthalpy of mixing of material. And for example, if you look at this enthalpy of mixing for different material, iron and tantalum, they like to mix. So you're going to favor mixing with ion irradiation for these two elements. But if you look at iron and Mg, for example, they don't like a mix. So basically, if you have two different interfaces, you can have different effects at both interfaces. But it's very interesting because you can play with the thermodynamic as well. And this is what we have demonstrated. If you start, for example, with a perfect crystallized material, strong perpendicular anisotropy, and you irradiate at room temperature, basically what you are doing is you induce intermixing at both interfaces, but with a higher rate of intermixing as the bottom interface, because tungsten and iron, or tungsten, cobalt, and tungsten and boron, they like to mix. And what you can do, if you look at the anisotropy versus fluence, you have a very precise control of intermixing, and so a very precise control of interface anisotropy. So it's a post-growth process to control anisotropy, for example. And now if you do ion irradiation at a moderate temperature, you can do the opposite. Here you can start with an amorphous material, and by increasing the fluence, you see you can increase this anisotropy field, and you can crystallize your material and at much lower temperatures than pure anion. So basically you can do disordering, and you can do ordering depending on the temperature conditions. And finally, it's a very powerful tool because you can do it at different steps of the manufacturing process. You can do it at the level of the material. You can irradiate full wafers. You can irradiate device after their fabrication, and you can also use a mask. So basically, you can modify locally the magnetic property of your device. So you have many new free parameters to control magnetic properties of spintronic devices. So this is what we have demonstrated recently. For example, this is if you irradiate locally this all cross, you can, using spin orbit torque, you can localize spin orbit torque switching. And by reducing the anisotropy here locally by 10%, you can get deterministic switching at low current density. So you can really control the spin orbit torque switching. If you do the same for skirmion devices, here we make channels with local ion irradiation. You can control the nucleation and the channeling of skirmions. So basically here you have two channels with lower anisotropy, and by sending a current, you can channel the skirmion motion along the channel. And recently we also demonstrated with Sensitec, so it's a sensor company, that we can control the strain in thick permalloy films for sensors, and even cancel completely the strain for a certain fluence, which is very interesting for a sensor. And for all optical switching, so it's cobalt gadolinium layers, we can also reduce by just intermixing the interface between cobalt and gadolinium, we can improve the efficiency of all optical switching. We can really play with different material for different applications. And I would say it's a universal process because it can be applied to other type of material. So in this talk, I'm gonna first show you that we can improve the crystallization process in these cobalt iron boron MgO layers, and reduce also the edge damages in use by physical etching. And studying disorder is very challenging. You need to use a very specific techniques, but in our case, there is a very, I would say, easy tool to study disorder in this magnetic field. It's a domain wall motion. As you know, when you look at the velocity versus the driving force, which can be a magnetic field or current, you have this very specific dynamical regimes. At high driving force, you have a flow regime where the domain wall is not sensitive to the underlying disorder. And you have a very flat domain wall on very high domain wall velocity. But there is a thermally activated regime where the wall, domain wall, is very sensitive to disorder. This is called the creep regime. And basically, in this regime, you have like a 10 order of magnitude in velocity. You can really access to information about the disorder. And basically, the disorder, because the domain wall energy is proportional to the exchange, anisotropy, Diazolski-Moria interaction, any variation, spatial variation of this parameter give rise to pinning. And you can see here that in this regime, the domain wall is not flat, but very roof due to a nanoscale defect. Okay, so the first one is improving crystallization. So for that, so we have started with amorphous film, tungsten cobalt iron boron MgO. So this is basically the free layer in magnetic tunnel junction. We have 2D domain wall motion in three different samples, one anneal at 400 degrees C. This is the current temperature you need to get high TMR on crystallization in MTG. And we have used two irradiation process, one and two, at a low temperature. So the irradiation has been performed with our tool. And we have used Kerr macroscopy, VSM, VLS FMR, TOF-SIMS, and TEM to characterize all these different samples. First, we can see that for the three different treatments handling on this two irradiation process, we have strong perpendicular anisotropy. So all these measurements are consistent with crystallization, strong perpendicular anisotropy. If you look at TOF-SIMS, we can see that the borom is not anymore in the cobalt aluminum borom layer, but into the tantalum, into the tungsten, which is a sign of crystallization. And when you look at TM images, you can also see the crystallization of the cobalt aluminum borom layer at the interface with the MgO in the anneal on irradiated case. Now, if you look at the magnetic parameter for the three samples, they are very similar. Basically, same effective anisotropy, same damping, and almost the same Diallo-Zeiskimori interaction on MS value. We have a slight difference here, but I will show you that it's consistent with a better order in the irradiated sample. Now, if you look at domain wall velocity, you have the same magnetic parameter, but if you look at domain wall motion, it's you can see a strong difference. For the anneal sample, so here it's much below the depinning field, and here it's close to the depinning field. You can see that in the anneal sample, you have this fractal motion of domain wall, which means that you have a disorder, underlying disorder in your system. And now if you look at the two irradiation samples, you have a smoother domain wall, even at very low field. And this is also consistent with a domain wall motion, where for irradiated sample, you can see a much faster domain wall velocity than pure annealing. So this already is consistent with lower disorder. Now you can analyze this domain wall velocity as a function of the applied field. Here it's a creep law indicated here. I don't want to get into the detail, but basically you have three regimes: creep, an intermediate depinning regime, and here it's a pre-flow regime. And by analyzing these two regimes with this law, you can have access to the energy barrier, creep energy barrier, with this important parameter TD here, and you can also have access to HD, which is a depinning field. So two important parameters. And if you do so, you can see that for the irradiation sample, you have a strong reduction of this TD parameter. So basically, you have a lower energy barrier for domain wall motion in the creep regime, which is consistent with lower disorder. And also by having access to these two parameters, TD on HD and the other magnetic parameter, MS, and you can have access to two different important parameters. So this is a study of Vincent Jeudy at LPS. You can have access to the characteristic pinning range and to the distance between pinning sites. This is basically the density of pinning. And you can see that you have a strong reduction also of the pinning length scale with ion irradiation. So Xi here, and the density of, sorry, the distance pin between a pinning site here in red. And finally, if you look beyond the depinning regime, in this precessional regime, you have a plateau. And in this regime, you expect the position of the height of the plateau to be proportional to D over MS, which is a Diallo-Zeiskimori interaction. And you have only a weak dependence in our study here. And basically, to recover the full behavior at high field, you need to introduce a distribution of anisotropy in each grain of the material on a distribution of grain size in the material. On this measurement has, are also consistent with a reduction of the anisotropy distribution in the irradiated sample on also a reduction reduction of the distribution of grain size in the irradiated sample. So putting everything together, we can draw now the disorder landscape, which is consistent with a lower variability in irradiated sample. So this is a spatial variation of the disorder. So this is the pinning energy. So for the anneal sample, you have a distribution of barrier height, and you have high barrier height. And for the irradiated sample, you have weaker pinning barrier and also denser pinning site. So you can see you have this blue variation, and you have a lower distribution. And we think that this is because we have a better crystallinity in this irradiated sample and sharper interfaces. And actually, we have demonstrated that we can increase the TMR ratio in a magnetic tunnel junction by 10% using this ion irradiated process. Okay, for the last part of my, so I've shown you that it's possible to improve the intrinsic, to reduce intrinsic defects in a material. Now I'm going to show you that we can reduce edge damages. So for that, we have designed these specific wires. In the middle, you have a large reservoir, which basically you have the properties of the full film. And then you have different wires with different sizes going out of this reservoir with sizes ranging from 5 to 40 microns. So it's micronic wires. And we have used local ion irradiation to reduce, to irradiate the edges of these fabricated wires with two different fluents, one to reduce locally the PMA, and another one to get fully paramagnetic. So if you look at the non-irradiated wires as a function of the width, so going from the reservoir to 40 micron to 5 micron, you can see that in the 40 micron wires, you have approximately the same domain wall velocity as in the reservoir. So it's like a full films. But if you reduce the width, you can see that you strongly reduce the domain wall velocity. Here in green for 10 micron, in red for 5 micron. And this is because you have edge damages. And if you look at the domain wall motion in the 10 micron wire, you can see that you have this curved domain wall propagating. And these curvatures is induced by local pinning at the edges. It's because of ion beam etching. And so you have a lower velocity at the edges of the wire than in the middle of the wire. And so the signature of edge pinning here is domain wall curvature and reduce domain wall velocity. Now, if you look at the irradiated wires, so in green, it's the local ion irradiation here. And in this part, you don't have a local irradiation. You can see that for the smaller fluents, so here it's non-irradiated, and here it's irradiated, you have a reduction of the curvature. And for the highest fluents, where you get paramagnetic, you can see here, you have a perfectly flat domain wall. 20 micron, perfectly flat domain wall. And the same for 10 micron on a flat domain wall. And 5 micron, it's more difficult to see, but you have also, you can also see an effect of local ion irradiation. So you can, this is basically an indication that you can reduce edge spinning by doing this local ion irradiation. And now if you look at domain hole velocity, you can see that here it's very slow, and here you have an acceleration of the domain hole in this part because of local edge irradiation. You can see the wall is propagating much faster in this part. And if you look at domain hole velocity now, you can see that, so you still have the reservoir, the pristine wire in red, not irradiated. And you can see that for the smallest fluence, you have an increase of domain hole velocity, factor of 2. But for the second fluence, when you get paramagnetic, you recover perfectly the domain hole velocity of the reservoir and the full film. So which means that you have really canceled the edge damages of the magnetic wire. Okay, and this is my last slide. Another way of fabricating magnetic wires is to do magnetic patterning. So this has been demonstrated by Claude Schaper a long time ago. So this is a conventional way of fabricating wires. You use a mask and you use argon etching. And as you have seen, you introduce a defect here at the edges. And another way of making these wires is still to use a mask, but using helium ion irradiation. And basically, you don't edge the material, but you kill the magnetism here at the edges. You can make it paramagnetic, as we have seen. And now, if you do so, you can also see that the wall keep moving without any curvature in these wires. So this means that in fabricating the wire like that, you don't induce edge damages. And the conclusion is that the edge damages is not induced by the resolution of the mask, but by the ion etching process. Basically, it's because you use argon, then you destroy the magnetic properties at the edges. Yeah, and finally, this is the same. If you look at domain hole velocity, in that kind of magnetic patterning, you can recover the full domain hole velocity of the full film, of the reservoir. Okay, so this is my conclusion. I hope I have shown you that helium ion irradiation is a powerful way to post-process material and devices. We have demonstrated lower variability in material crystallized by ion irradiation. And this is not shown here, but now we have the demonstration that we can do it in a full magnetic tunnel junction with an increase of TMR and lower variability, which is very important for MRAM and sensor application. We have also shown that edge damages can be reduced by a local patterning. And we hope that this new manufacturing process can be used for a future spintronic application. So thank you very much for your attention, and I want to thank all our collaborators and principally Rian, who is a PhD student who has performed this work. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Daphne, for this really interesting talk. With, I suppose that there are many questions. Okay, Matthias is. yes, but yeah, okay. We go with Matthias first, and then Martin can ask his question.
Hey, thanks, Daphne. Very exciting. I should probably know this, but what is the origin of the reduction of the edge pinning? Because you said there's no etching, so the topography of the edge should not change. So if the topography doesn't change, why is the edge pinning changing?
Because the We cannot hear at distance the answer.
Oh, you have to move back the microphone.
And so by using helium, you basically kill all this magnetic gradient by killing the magnetic properties and making it paramagnetic. So basically, the pinning is not due to the roughness. It's really due to a distribution of magnetic properties at the edges. Oh, yeah. No, so first the fluence is quite low, but we have checked that after a while the ion moves away from the wire, for example, because it's light ion, and you don't want to use high fluences because then you can get bubbles, and this can be detrimental for these devices.
Actually, I have a follow-up question because just on the making the material paramagnetic, so I didn't quite get what is the origin of that. How do you make the layer paramagnetic?
So here basically you have a 1 nanometer of cobalt iron boron, and by increasing the fluence, you increase the intermixing with the tungsten, and at the end you get a full paramagnetic alloy. So you need a higher fluence for that.
Okay, so it's clear. Okay, Martin, go.
Yeah, thanks, Daphne, for this very nice presentation. It's very exciting to see you controlling these junctions and the materials at post deposition. And so my question was, I was wondering if you had considered playing with the oxygen vacancies in the MgO barrier. Since these oxygen vacancies can, they drive the RA ratio, and they can affect or under certain circumstances even enhance spintronic performance. And it seems like you have the tool to be able to play with that parameter post-deposition. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, for the crystallization process, we have seen that we have, looking at the RA, all the resistance property of the barrier, we think we have a better MgO barrier, better crystallized than using pure annealing. So in terms of vacancy, I think we have less vacancies in this MgO barrier when we use this crystallization process. But when you do the opposite, when you start from a pure crystalline barrier and you increase the fluence, basically to induce intermixing. In this case, we can induce some, oxygen vacancy in the barrier. And now we are currently using this process, for example, for magneto-ionics to improve ionic mobilities in different type of oxide. So you can do both. You can reduce vacancy or you can increase vacancies depending on the condition you use.
Of course, if you combine this with photoluminescence, you would be able to determine whether you have single, double, or multiple oxygen vacancies. And double oxygen vacancies clearly have a positive impact on spintronic performance. That's why I mentioned all of this.
Yes. Yes, this is something we are studying also, yes, to look at the at these properties, what is a tunneling effect after ion irradiation, yes.
Thank you.
Lucien?
Yes, so thank you for the presentation, Daphne. So on the same question as Martin, more or less, so on the uniformity of the MgO tunnel barrier, so in order to adjust those non-uniformities, oxygen vacancies, different type of processes can play a role. So why the irradiation plays a more advantageous role than adjusting the annealing condition themselves?
Yeah, because basically when you do ion irradiation for each helium ions, it's very schematic, you can induce a crystallite. You can nucleate a crystallite. Whereas when you do pure annealing, basically you get a crystallite nucleation at some part of your magnetic material where you have some local defect, and you have only a few nucleation of crystallite. With ion irradiation, it's much more homogeneous because you can include much more crystallite when you do the process. And this is why we believe we have a better uniformity than pure annealing. Basically, we reduce the nucleation eight barrier by assisting the crystallization with ion irradiation.
Okay. And do you think that irradiation is more advantageous if done at a specific layer growth in the stack, or doing it at the end for the whole stack plays the same role as maybe after the MgO deposition doing the irradiation?
It's not a secret, but it's more complicated when you do it at the end of the process. Doing it sequentially can be also very interesting. But in this case, yes, you need to connect ion beam tool to a deposition tool. And this is also something we have developed.